So, if you've been trading the last week, you must have seen that big down move that we've seen on the S&P 500. The S&P lost around 5% in the span of like 3-4 days, and it already even recovered some of those losses. And I think that the last time we've seen a down move like this one was in October 2020. And in this video, I wanted to share with you why down moves like this one are actually great opportunities, and even though they might seem bad at first, they're actually sources of amazing opportunities, and that's what I wanted to talk about in this video. And I know that right from the get-go, saying that, you know, down move or big down move like we've seen, for example, during that last week is actually a great opportunity might seem counterintuitive. But let me explain the reasons why it's really an amazing opportunity, and if you like to sell options, it's usually the best times to sell options. But before diving into this video, if at any point you find this video interesting or helpful and maybe you actually learned something, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel and liking this video. As I always say, it's the best support you can give me, and in my analysis, after that, I know which type of videos you actually like to watch and which videos you'd like to see more of. So first of all, I'm going to talk about what I call the problem with selling options in this type of environment, and I'm going to explain the reasons why I think that there are some issues sometimes when you sell options, especially in this type of low implied volatility environment. And after that, I'm going to talk about why this type of down move is actually solving all of our problems and why it's actually a great source of opportunities. So let's talk about what happened before that down move so we can understand why it's actually such a great opportunity. Since the COVID crash, the stock market literally just went up like straight. Maybe we had sometimes some down moves like in June 2020, in September 2020, in October 2020 if I remember well, but overall the stock market just went up, and the stock market just didn't recover the losses that it had during the COVID crash. It actually went past the levels that we were at before the COVID crash and literally made new highs all the times. And the stock market going up isn't a problem in itself. It's not really the problem. The problem is if the stock market just keeps going up without doing any pullbacks. And let me explain. When the market goes up, the implied volatility tends to go down. But what is the implied volatility? Well, the implied volatility is literally just a reflection of option prices. And what does that mean? Well, that means that if option prices are getting cheaper, then the implied volatility will go down. And if option prices get more expensive, then the implied volatility will go up. And what we tend to see usually is that when the stock market goes up, we tend to see the implied volatility going down overall for all of the stocks. And when there is a sudden down move, then we see the implied volatility going up very quickly. Proof of option prices getting very expensive all of a sudden. And to give you a bit of context and example so it's completely clear, let's go into Tastyworks so I can show you that. So we are in the Tastyworks platform, and what we are looking at right now is what we call the VIX. The VIX, you might have heard it under the name of fear index. That's usually what investors are looking at when the stock market is going down very quickly. We look at this VIX, which is basically the implied volatility for the index, for the S&P 500, meaning that the VIX is literally just the implied volatility for the S&P 500. And we tend to refer to the VIX as the fear index because when the stock market crashes, we tend to see the VIX going up very quickly. For example, if we go back to March 2020 when the COVID crash happened, you see that the VIX went literally from 16 to almost 85 and very quickly. You see that it went from 17 to almost 85 in the span of 15 days, if actually not less. And that's explained because usually the stock market tends to go down a lot quicker than when it goes up. So if you see a crash happening, if we look at, for example, the SPY, which is the S&P 500 ETF, if we look back at what happened in March 2020, we see that the S&P 500 fell very quickly. And if basically we were, you know, putting the S&P 500 chart onto the VIX chart, you would see that it's literally the opposite. When the S&P 500 goes down very quickly, you're going to see the VIX, and let me come back to the VIX, you're going to see the VIX go up very quickly, exactly at the same time. And as the stock market recovers, the VIX tends to go down. But why am I talking about this in the first place? Why is it even relevant? It's relevant because the VIX is a bit like a thermometer. The higher the VIX, the higher, let's say, the temperature, meaning that the more we actually expect from the S&P 500. But as I said before, if the implied volatility is really high, it means that option prices are actually very expensive. If the VIX is really low, it means that option prices are very cheap at the moment. And as as an option seller, when we sell options, we want to sell expensive options so we can buy them back at lower prices and make a profit overall. That's, you know, shorting options. But when you have the VIX that is really low, it's very hard to make money as an option seller because you're going to sell very cheap options to make a very tiny margin and you're not going to make a lot of money. That's why when the VIX is really low, option sellers tend to not make as much money as when the VIX is actually really high. Because think about it. If the VIX goes, for example, to 85 like in March 2020, then it means that options overall across the S&P 500 are very expensive overall. Meaning that if you start selling options when the VIX is around 85, you're going to make a lot more money as an option seller compared to someone who would sell options when the VIX is around 12, for example. The problem here and what we were getting into for the last month, during those last months, the stock market just kept going up and up. It was a constant grind up. And if we look at the SPY, as I said, the S&P 500 ETF, you see that the stock market literally went up and almost without any interruption since November. You see that we had some interesting down moves, for example, in August or for example, in October. But after that, it was mostly of a constant grind up, maybe except in February for several days, but that was it. And the problem with the stock market not doing any pullbacks, any real down moves, is that the implied volatility started going lower and lower, and the options started getting cheaper and cheaper, making the potential earnings as an option seller very low. You started making way less money, for example, in March, April, compared to when we were, for example, during 2020, when the VIX was way higher. And I love to sell options. That's the thing that I do the most. I tend to sell options mostly. It's very rare that I trade, you know, by buying options. I tend to make money by selling options mostly. And as the market overall kept going higher and higher, I started making less and less money on the options because they were just too cheap to actually take the risk. I wasn't really making good money for the risk that I was taking. So it was not even worth trading the options because they were too cheap. But you would tell me now that I said this, now that I said that it's hard for option sellers to make money when the stock market just keep going up because options get cheaper and cheaper and it's harder and harder to actually make money by selling options because they get so cheap. So you would ask me, why don't you switch to buying options? You know, if options get so cheap, maybe switch to buying options instead of selling options. So, you know, you can actually make some money like that. And it's a fair statement. You could definitely switch to, for example, LEAPS, long-term equity anticipation securities, and start making money that way. For example, I could have started buying LEAPS, and LEAPS being options that are at least 1 year away from expiration. And in this type of very low implied volatility environment, it's actually nice to buy LEAPS because they cost less money than if we're in a very high implied volatility environment. So in the end, you would make a good deal. And it's true. However, personally, I like to sell options and maintain an option portfolio that way. And personally, I found that making money, or at least trying to make consistent returns by selling options, was way more doable compared to buying options. Based on my own experience, and maybe there are some people that make great money by buying options and it's nice for them, but personally, I've never really experienced a real consistent way of making money by buying options. It's only by selling options that I've had actually the best returns. And that leads me to talk about why this down move that we've seen during the last week was actually quite nice. Because the S&P went down so quickly in the span of 3 days, I think it lost around 5% or something. And if we go, for example, in the chart of the SPY and we zoom in, you see that the SPY on May 10th opened at $422 per share and it went down in the span of 3 days to $405 per share. So you see that it's not a big, big down move. I mean, it could have been a lot worse and we've seen a lot worse. However, it was enough of a down move so as to bring more volatility into the markets. What does that mean? Well, it means that as the volatility came back in the markets, options got more expensive, generating opportunities for option sellers. And if we, for example, look at the VIX, we're going to see that the VIX on May 10th, it went from 17 on May 10th to almost 28 on May 12th. And what does that mean? Well, it means that options overall on May 12th were way more expensive compared to when we were, for example, on May 7th. And it means that as an option seller, we had amazing opportunities to make money. Options got a lot more expensive and we had way more opportunities to sell options, at least making the risk worth taking. And that was a great opportunity for me to place more trades because I had a better edge here. I had a better edge because I knew that options options weren't going to stay that expensive. They just got more expensive because the market went down so quickly, and so that pushed option prices higher. And that's where it's really nice when you start looking at these type of things, because now you can adjust your strategies based on the VIX levels. And that's something that I apply to myself that I think is very nice, and let me explain it to you. The thing is, you cannot predict where the market is going to go. You cannot predict when it's going to be the next crash or when it's going to be the next big down move. I mean, that's not possible. However, what you can do is adjust the way you're trading based on the VIX, based on where the VIX is right now. And what do I mean by this? Well, I said that when the VIX gets really low, it's very hard to make money as an option seller. But when the VIX get higher all of a sudden, that's why options are getting way more expensive, and that's why there's a lot more money to make as an option seller. So if we think about it, it makes sense to adjust the level of capital invested in the market based on the VIX level. When the VIX is really low, I tend to be way less invested in the markets. I have way less exposure. And when the VIX gets higher, I tend to put more money into the market because that's where my opportunity is to make money. That's where my edge is. And I know it can seem counterintuitive to think like this, meaning that when the S&P goes down very quickly, it's actually the opportunity to make more money and get invested more into the markets. I know it seems counterintuitive. However, as an option seller, that's where the opportunity is. That's where you make more money. That's when the VIX gets high that you have the opportunity to make more money. And that's when you should actually take advantage of that. And on the other hand, when the VIX gets really low, that's where you need to be careful about the money invested in the markets, because you have less edge here. You're not making a good money for the risk that you're taking. And personally, if the VIX is under 20, I tend to be around 30% of all my buying power invested. Meaning that if you have $10,000, well, if the VIX is below 20, then I would be invested maximum at $3,000. Out of those $10,000, I would only invest $3,000 into option trades. However, if the VIX goes above 20, then I'm going to place more trades. I'm going to get more invested in the markets. So you would ask me, how far do I go? Well, maximum, I'm going to set a limit to 50% of my buying power invested. Meaning that if we take back our example of the $10,000 account, it means that maximum, I would put $5,000 in option trades at any given time. Maximum. I wouldn't go above this. And the reason for that is that I want to keep margin of safety. I want to keep cash in my account in case I need to roll my trades. So at least I will have the buying power available so as to roll my trades. But that's what I mean by adjusting your level of capital invested based on the VIX levels. Because if you think about it, and this is something that took me a long time to understand, so hopefully it's helpful for you. Let me know if it's going to be helpful. When the VIX is low, that's where you are at the most risk of getting burned. And let me explain why. If you want to trade, let's say Apple, and the implied volatility is really, really low, then options are going to be priced accordingly. Meaning that if you want to make some good money, you're going to have to sell a very close at the money option so as to make some good money. Compared to if there is a very high implied volatility on Apple, then options are going to be priced accordingly. Meaning that you won't need to go as close to the at the money strike to make good money. You will be able to go way further at the money and still make some good money, because the more expensive the options, the higher the implied volatility. So in the end, when the implied volatility is very high, that's not where you have the biggest risk. It's when the market is calm and nothing is happening and the implied volatility is really low that it's actually the riskiest to trade when you sell options. Because if something happens, you're going to get into a drawdown very, very quickly. And on the opposite, when the VIX gets higher, when the implied volatility gets higher, that's your chance as an option seller to take advantage of that. I hope it makes sense. And personally, applying this for me, applying this type of levels of capital invested based on the VIX levels, I think it's honestly been amazing for me, because it allowed me to really understand that when the markets are calm, that's actually when it's the riskiest to trade. And it's not when there is volatility in the markets that it's actually the riskiest time to trade, because now options are priced accordingly and you can sell very far at the money options without being scared of getting into a drawdown if the market starts moving. If we go back to the VIX chart, when the VIX was around 26, I started selling more options on different stocks because the options just got way more expensive, and that was an opportunity for me to take advantage of that. And of course, the challenge, and that's always the biggest challenge, is to be patient. Because when the VIX is low, when the implied volatility is low, you're not going to make as much money as when it's high. So it's very hard to stay patient when the VIX is really low, because you need to. You need to stay patient, you need to keep your capital. You shouldn't be too invested, because when volatility gets high, that will be your opportunity to shine and to start selling more options and make more money that way. But until then, that's always, always important to stay patient. And personally, I struggle with that. I'm not perfect at all. It's always very hard for me to stay patient and not be too invested when nothing is happening, because you feel like you're missing out on potential profits. But I can assure you that when the VIX gets high like it did right now, when it topped around 27, 28 level, well, it's very nice after that when you start selling options, because now you have all of that capital that you can use to sell options that are actually worth it, where there is a good profit potential. I hope this video makes sense and now you understand a bit more why I think that this type of down moves is actually very healthy, and it contributes to making the options market more pricey, which is very nice when you sell options. And don't hesitate to share also below if that's something that you were already using. Were you already using the VIX as an indicator to know how much you should be invested in the market? I'm very curious to hear your answers, so don't hesitate to comment it below. Please make good and informed decisions. I'll see you in the next video, and in the meantime, I wish you all the best.